Hello everyone and welcome to our today's class. It is our sixth topic in the Form 1 work. But before I begin, let me start by giving you the quote of the day, which states that two things define us in life. One is our patience when we have nothing, and two is our humility when we have everything. So today we are looking at thermal expansion. So before we even discuss the topic, we need to understand the title itself. So what do we mean by the word thermal? So thermal is from the word heat, then expansion from English. It is actually derived from an English verb, which is to expand. So to expand in English actually means to increase in size. So that means that in under thermal expansion, we'll be looking at substances increasing in size as a result of heat. For example, heating a metallic material, we expect it to increase in size or to expand. So let's start by looking at some definitions here. And our first definition is about temperature. So under temperature, we look at definitions, the instrument and the units for measuring temperature. Now, what is temperature? So temperature is defined as a measure of the degree or the extent of coldness or hotness of an object on measured on some chosen scale. The degree or extent of coldness or hotness of an object measured on some chosen scale. Then what instrument do we use to measure temperature? So temperature is measured by an instrument called a thermometer. So a thermometer is the instrument that we use to measure temperature. Now temperature is measured by various units. The common units are the degrees Celsius, although we can also use what we call the Kelvin. So the SI unit, that is the international standard units of measurement for temperature, is what we call the Kelvin. So you can remember that we talked of those units in our topic, that is a measurement one. So temperature is measured in a Kelvin, that is the SI units of temperature, although it can also be measured in a degrees Celsius. So Kelvin is a scalar quantity. Remember we said that a scalar quantity is a quantity that has magnitude or size only, but it does not have the direction. Two, we look at expansion and contraction of solids. So expansion is from the word to expand. We have said that to expand is actually to increase in size or to increase in volume, because volume is the amount of space occupied by a body. Then to contract is the opposite of expansion. So to contract means to decrease or reduce in size. So we are looking at expansion and contraction of solids. Remember we differentiated the different states of matter in terms of their particle arrangement, that is in solid state, in liquid state, and in gaseous state. So to understand what we mean by expansion and contraction in solids, we'll be looking at some two experiments which will help us understand the or to show or ascertain that expansion and contraction takes place in solids. So the first experiment is called the ball and ring experiment. So in this experiment, the apparatus required are, one, we have the metallic ball, then we also have a metal ring. We may also need a chain, that is to connect the metallic ball onto the handle. So in this experiment, that is part of the procedure in the experiment, the metallic ball is heated, maybe using something like a Bunsen burner or any other appropriate measuring instrument. Then it is, after being heated, it is placed on the metal ring. Now remember, the ball should be in such a way that at room temperature, that is when the metal ball is not heated and also when the metal ring is not heated, the ball should just be fitting through or passes through the metal ring, that is at room temperature before heating. So in this experiment, the ball is usually heated and placed on the metal ring, then an observation is done about whether the ball will go through the metal ring or not. So it is observed that when the ball is heated without heating the metal ring, the ball does not go through the metal ring. However, at room temperature, the ball just goes through the metal ring. Now, the question is, why does the ball decline or refuse to go through the metal ring? So this is because when the metal ball is heated, it actually expands. Remember, a metal ball is a solid, so that shows that solids can expand. So the observation made is that when the metal ball is heated, it does not pass through the metal ring. Why? Because it has been heated and therefore it has expanded. So when a substance expands, it means it increases in size or in volume. Therefore, because the volume of the metal ball or the size of the metal ball has increased, but the volume of the metal ring is the same, because the metal ring has not been heated, it is the metal ball that has been heated, it means the metal ball has increased in size, therefore does not go through the metal ring because it has expanded. However, when the metal ball is left resting on the metal ring, that is after some time, for example, when you come to check it, maybe after something like 15 minutes, it is observed that after some time, the ball, which has been heated, finally goes through the metal ring. Now, the question is, why does the ball go through the metal ring? That is after resting on the metal ring after some time. So remember, when the ball is left resting on the surface of the metal ring, it cools. Now, that heat that the metallic ball loses as a result of cooling, the same heat is absorbed by the metal ring. So remember, metals will always expand when heated. So the ball loses heat, therefore it contracts or it reduces in size. At the same time, the metal ring gains the heat lost by the metal ball, therefore the metal ring expands. Now, when the metal ring has expanded, at the same time the metal ball has contracted, it means now the space available to be filled by the metal ball is actually more than the size of the metal ball. Therefore, the metal ball easily goes through the metal ring. So the questions asked here are, one is that you state the expected observation. So when the metal ball is heated, it does not go through the metal ring. Why? Because the metal ball has expanded, but the metal ring was not heated. Therefore, the metallic ball easily passes through the metal ring. However, when the metal ball is left on the ring for some time, the metal ball actually loses heat or it cools. A cooling in solids or metallic substances is accompanied by a reduction in volume, or it contracts. So when the metal ball contracts, at the same time the metal ring expands, because it has gained the heat lost by the metal ball, it means now the space available is large, therefore the metal ball easily goes through the metal ring. So you'll be asked to state the expected observation. When the metal ball is heated, that is, it does not go through the metal ring. The observation expected when the metal ball is left on the metallic ring for some time is that it goes through the metal ring. Why? Because it contracts. So when it contracts, because it is losing heat. At the same time, the metal ring expands because it is gaining heat. Therefore, that's why finally the metal ball goes through the metal ring, because the metal ball contracts while the metallic ring expands because it is gaining heat. Now, the second experiment which we are looking at to ascertain that actually expansion and contraction takes place in our solids is what we call the bar and gauge experiment. So in this experiment, the expected apparatus is a Bunsen burner or any other source of heat. We also need a metal bar. This is our metal bar, which is blue in color. Then we also need a gauge. So this is actually what we are calling our gauge. Then these are just lines showing the perpendicular distance which the metal bar should fit into the gauge. So initially, or that is at room temperature, it is observed that the metal bar is made in such a way that it easily fits into the metal, the gauge. However, when the metal bar is heated, then tried to pass through the same gauge, it is observed that the metal bar does not fit into the gauge. Now, what is the reason behind this? So remember, when you hit a metal gauge, which is a solid, it expands or it increases in size. Now, whenever the metal bar expands or increases in size, remember the metal, the gauge has not increased in size. The space that the metal bar was fitting into the gauge is still the same, but the metal bar is the one that has increased in size because we usually hit the metal bar. So when it is heated, it increases in size. Therefore, because its size has increased, therefore it means it does not fit into the gauge. However, when you cool the metal bar after some time, maybe like 15 minutes, it will be observed that the metal bar again goes through the gauge. So that ascertains or proves that solids, in most cases metals, will always expand and contract. So those are the two experiments that can be used to ascertain or show that metals or solids can expand and contract. Then we also look at what we call linear expansivity. Now, the word linear from English means actually straight or maybe moving in a straight line. Then expansivity is from a word, a verb, to expand. So to expand, we said earlier, that means to increase in size. So let's look at a few definitions involving linear expansivity. Now, what is expansivity? So expansivity is the tendency of a material to increase in size. Then linear expansivity, now this is the ability of a material to increase in size when heated. The ability of a material, in most cases metals, to increase in size when heated. So here is a table summarizing the linear expansivity rates for different metals. For example, aluminium here has the highest linear expansivity rate of 26, followed by brass 19, copper 16.8, followed by iron, concrete, steel, glass, platinum alloy, silica, pyrex, and finally the invar. So under this table, we use linear expansivity have huge extension in the application of making certain substances or instruments which are very applicable in physics. For example, we have what we call the bimetallic strip. Now, the common questions asked here are, one, a student can be asked to explain why when we are building or in construction, remember when houses are being built, we usually use concrete. Concrete is mostly a mixture of maybe cement, we have some stones, and maybe some sand. So when we are building, we usually use concrete with steel, the steel wires. Why is it that when during construction, we usually use concrete and steel to reinforce the building? Or why do we use steel to reinforce concrete during building? So this is because, remember here, we are seeing that concrete has a linear expansivity rate of 11. Steel also has a linear expansivity rate of 11. So simply this means that concrete and steel expand at the same rate. Therefore, it means that when there is a deviation in temperatures, that is when the temperatures increase, concrete and steel will expand at the same rate. Also, when the temperatures are low, concrete and steel will contract at the same rate. So that uniformity in the contraction and expansion of concrete and steel avoids cracking. Remember, cracking is brought about by deviations or differences in the expansion rates of materials which have been put or riveted together. So a question can be asked here, maybe a student can be asked to explain why, for example, steel and not copper is used in reinforcing concrete. So if you look at concrete and copper, they have different expansion rates. Copper has a high expansion rate of 16.8, while concrete has a lower expansion rate of 11. So that means when the temperatures are high, copper will expand faster, while concrete will expand slowest. So it means because the copper is expanding faster than the concrete, it means when you make a building using copper with concrete, actually there is a very high likelihood of cracks within that building. Why will there be cracks? Because when the temperatures are high, the copper is expanding at a faster rate than the concrete. When the temperatures are low, the copper will contract at a faster rate than the concrete. So that imbalance or that difference in the linear expansivity of copper and concrete makes it not suitable preference for use in a building. So when we are building, we prefer using concrete and steel wires because they have exactly the same linear expansivity. So that means they will always expand and contract at the same rate. So that uniformity in the expansion and contraction rate is what will ensure that there is no crack within that building. Then another common question usually asked based on this table is we have the glass here, then we have the Pyrex. We have the Pyrex. So there is a question that is usually asked that explain why a tumbler made of glass, when poured in with hot water, is likely to break, as opposed to a tumbler which is made of Pyrex. So why is it that when we pour hot water in a tumbler made of glass, is likely to break, as opposed to a tumbler made of Pyrex, Pyrex material? So here is the reason. One, remember the glass is usually thick. Then here we are seeing that the glass has a higher linear expansivity than the Pyrex. So the glass has a linear expansivity of 9, while the Pyrex has a linear expansivity of 3.2. So that means when you pour hot water into glass, because it is thick and it has a higher linear expansivity, remember when it is thick, it means it has different layers. So we have the inner layer, which the hot water will actually be in contact with before actually the heat is distributed to the outer layer. So when hot water is poured into that glass, it means the inner layer will, because it is thick and it has a higher linear expansivity, it means the inner layer will expand faster than the outer layer. Because remember that heat from the hot water will first be distributed to the inner layer before it is transferred to the outer layer. Again, remember glass is usually a poor conductor of heat. So it means there will be an imbalance between the heat distribution between the outer layer and the inner layer. So that imbalance or an unequal heat distribution between the inner layer and the outer layer will cause the inner layer and the outer layer to expand at different rates. So that imbalance in the rate of expansion is what will cause what? Cracking of the a tumbler made of glass. On the other hand, or on contrary, Pyrex tumbler, Pyrex, remember, is usually a very thin material. So Pyrex is thin and it also has a low rate of linear expansivity. So because it is thin and it has a low rate of linear expansivity, it means that when hot water is poured into a Pyrex tumbler, it will expand at low rate. Again, its glass is that is its surface is thin. So that thinness of the surface and the low rate of linear expansivity ensures that heat within the Pyrex, because it is thin, it means it does not have many layers like the glass. So because the layer is thin, it means there will be uniform heat distribution within the Pyrex tumbler. So because there is uniform heat distribution, it means the Pyrex tumbler will not break. Because remember, what causes breaking is the imbalance between the rates of expansion and contraction of substances which are riveted together. Then I also want students to have a keen look at the expansion rates of brass and iron. So brass is having a linear expansivity of 19, then iron is having a linear expansivity of 12. So that means when brass and iron are riveted together, or when they are fixed together to make a particular substance, brass will always expand faster because it has a higher level of linear expansivity. Then it will also contract faster. Remember, a substance that expands faster will always contract faster. Then iron, because it has a low linear expansivity, that is as compared to brass, it means when they are riveted together, iron will always expand slowest, then it will always also contract slowest. So a substance of lower linear expansivity will always expand slower and also contract slower. But a substance of higher linear expansivity rate will always expand faster and it will always contract faster. So in that regard, we can look at one application of riveting this, any of these two methods. Remember, we have already explained two, that is in reinforcing steel with concrete, because they have the same linear expansivity, or they expand and contract at the same rate. We have also looked at why when you pour hot water in a glass tumbler, it will break. The reason we say this is because, one, the glass has it is thick, therefore it has the outer and the inner layer. Then its linear expansivity is high, so it means the layers expand at a higher rate. So because heat distribution within the glass surfaces is poor, because they are actually thick and they are poor conductors of heat, so the imbalance between the heat distribution, or the expansion rate of the inner layer of the glass and the outer layer of the glass, is what will cause breaking of that glass. Unlike for Pyrex, which is usually thin and its rate of expansion, or the linear expansivity, is low, so it means its rate of expanding and contracting is actually low, therefore it means there will be uniform heat distribution within the Pyrex tumbler, therefore it will not break. So the last application is we want to see how riveting brass and iron can be used to make some instruments which are important in physics. So in that regard, we look at what we call the bimetallic strip. Now, we need to understand what we mean by this title. What is bimetallic strip? So we'll start by defining the term one by one. So bi from English means two. Then metallic is from the word a metal. So it means in this case, we are taking bimetals. We are taking two metals, metallic materials, and then we are riveting together or fixing them together. Then a strip is just a combination of those two metals. They form a strip. Remember from our previous table, we actually saw that brass has a higher linear expansivity rate of 19, while iron has a lower linear expansivity rate of 12. So that means in any case, during heating, brass will always expand faster than iron. Then during cooling, brass will always contract faster than what? Iron. Remember, we are saying that a substance that has a higher linear expansivity will always expand at a higher rate, and it will always also contract at a higher rate. That is on cooling. Expansion, remember, it is on heating. But a substance of low linear expansivity like iron, it will always expand slowest, that is during heating, and it will always contract slowest, that is during cooling. So riveting these two metals is used in the application of what we call the bimetallic strip. So you can be asked to define what we mean by a bimetallic strip. So a bimetallic strip is just made by two metallic materials of different linear expansivity rates, which are riveted together. To rivet is just to fix them together to make them appear like one, like in this diagram here. So we have the brass here, we also have the iron here, but they have been riveted together. To rivet is to fix them together. So at room temperature, this one means that actually at the normal temperature of the room, that is the bimetallic strip, it is not heated, overheated, or it is not cooled. It is just at the room temperature. So at room temperature, the bimetallic strip, we expect it to appear in this shape, that it is linear. However, when we heat this bimetallic strip, maybe by use of a Bunsen burner or any other relevant source of heat, on heating, it is, remember we have said that a substance with higher linear expansivity rate will always expand faster on heating. So on heating, this will be the appearance of the above bimetallic strip. So this will be the appearance. Now, the most important thing here is to know the explanation behind that appearance. So here, it is observed that brass curves on the outwards while iron curves on the inwards. But the question is, why? Why does the bimetallic strip curve in this manner? So remember, heating a substance means its temperature will increase. Then remember, we said also from previous topics that when a solid is heated, we expect it to expand. When it is cooled, we expect it to contract. So when the bimetallic strip is subjected to a lot of heat, brass, because it has a higher expansivity rate than iron, it means on heating, brass will expand faster than iron. Now, when brass is expanding faster than iron, that is on heating, it means to expand means to increase in size. It means it will occupy the largest space. That is, it increases faster because it has a higher expansivity rate of 19. So if it expands faster, it means it will want to occupy the maximum space, which is of course from the outward. But because iron has a low linear expansivity rate, it means when heated, it will actually expand slower, that is as compared to brass. So brass, because it has a higher a larger linear expansivity rate, it expands faster, therefore occupying the maximum space or the largest space, because it has increased in size faster, therefore it occupies the outer layer, or it curves upward outwards. So curving outward, it means it is taking the maximum space possible because it has expanded. However, iron having a low linear expansivity rate, that is of 12, on heating, it actually expands slowest. So when it expands slowest, it means it will want to occupy the minimum space. Therefore, it curves inwards because this is where you can obtain the minimum space. But the brass curves upwards because it has a higher linear expansivity rate, that is of 19. Therefore, it expands faster, therefore occupying the outer space. However, on cooling, remember you have said that a substance that expands faster on cooling, it will always also contract faster. So on cooling, because brass has a higher linear expansivity rate, it means on cooling, that is on subjecting it to low temperatures, it will contract faster. So because brass contracts faster, it means to contract means to reduce in size, therefore it will occupy the minimum space possible. So to occupy the minimum space possible, it means it will curve inwards, that is as shown in this diagram. Then because iron has a low linear expansivity rate, that is of 12, it means on cooling, the iron will now cool at a lower rate. So when it cools at a lower rate, it means it will occupy, it will be longer as compared to brass, because remember, brass is contracting faster. Therefore, because iron is contracting slowest, it means it will occupy the maximum space. So that's why it curves upwards. So the questions common here are that you can be drawn the diagrams here, then you are expected to explain the observation. That is why the bimetallic strip curves this way, in this manner, that is with brass outwards on heating, and why it curves with brass inwards on cooling. So you have said why the bimetallic strip curves with brass outwards on heating is because brass expands faster than iron. Therefore, it curves outwards to occupy the maximum space. Then why the brass curves inwards, that is on cooling, is because it contracts faster. Therefore, occupies the minimum space possible as compared to iron, which contracts slowest. Remember, in some cases, they can use Inver instead of Ion. If you look at our previous table, you will see that Inver had an expansivity rate of 1. So sometimes it can be substituted with Inver here. So it is not necessarily that it will always be Ion. So we've come to the end of our class today, but we need to discuss the quote of the day. So the quote of the day said that two things define us in life. One is our patience when we have nothing, and two is our humility when we have everything. So the say simply means that when you have nothing in life, that is when you are in the process of building something, you need to have faith. You need to believe in yourself. You also need to have patience. Remember, patience is not defined by just sitting, doing nothing, and just saying that I'm being patient. Patience is defined by what you do while in that process of waiting. So don't just sit back and say that I'm being patient. Patience means is defined by what you do in that process of waiting. Also having the faith that whatever you are doing might be turned into something great. Then the second part, that we are also defined by our humility when you have everything. That is when you have achieved your dreams, or when you have achieved everything that you need in your life, you also need to remain humble. You need to remain humble. There is no need of showing some level of pride. Remember, even I think it is quoted somewhere in the Bible that God will always uplift those who humble themselves. And remember this, humility is the hardest virtue to achieve in life. Humility is the hardest virtue to achieve in life. Why? It is the hardest virtue to achieve in life because the ego, that is the self, likes being proud. Thank you, and hit that subscription button on YouTube. This is Kind Tuition Academy. Thank you.